Both Simi and Priyanka have journeyed through multiple roles in public relations, media, and marketing. This exchange of experiences highlights certain similarities and differences between India and Canada when it comes to education, work culture, and the passion with which information is received and used in both places.
Hey, so both of you have had more experience than me professionally and within the industry. So I'm curious to know from you, Simi, what changes have you observed between now and a few years ago in regards to education and work in PR? And when I say PR, I mean public relations.
Well, that's a great question. So let me just preface by saying that I'm far from an expert. I've been in the industry for 3 years. It's not my first career, so I started later in life after I moved to Toronto. So my comments are really very narrow because I was working for a very small company. So it was less than 10 people. And so I'm not sure how broad this my experience is for other people mm-hmm. and other situations. In my experience with this company, which worked in fundraising for nonprofit organizations, NGOs, and healthcare facilities, again, very narrow. When I joined them in 2016, I was there from 2016 to 2018, there was no interest at all in engaging with social media or digital platforms. Part of the reason for that, I think, was the nature of the leadership at that company, which had been there for 25 years and wasn't really connected to the broader culture out there as it evolved in communications. They'd never had a communications person really in the organization. So there wasn't a sense of appreciation for what the possibilities were in terms of increasing their revenue, you know, and the marketing possibilities with social media. And there was actual resistance. I would say more than lack of appreciation, there was real resistance to it. They didn't want to have to spend the money on hiring someone with the knowledge and devote the time to curating content. And I don't think they saw the value in it. I don't think they had really looked at the competition until I got there and started to sort of prod them a little bit. And then they started to look at channels and the way they were being used. So that said, it was a difficult time because I wasn't able to use my skills or grow there at all. So after working there, excuse me, for 2 years, I then went back to school, to PR school, and really got a sense full time. I had been taking night classes, so I had dipped my toe in the water, but I got a much broader sense of the value of PR and the different ways it could be used. Now I'm working with a company that is a B2B company, again, working with nonprofit organizations, but conducting virtual public engagement, telephone town halls. So they're not open to the public, but we deal with governments and unions and other public organizations. And I'm doing the social media for them and the website content. And it is really, we take for granted that everyone's going to be on, from a business point of view, everyone's going to be engaged with social media. But, you know, that's really not the case. I think it mm-hmm. depends largely on the sector yes. that we're talking about. So the nonprofit sector is really quite different from private sector. I think when we're in school and just looking at the media as a consumer, I think of private sector. You know, we're bombarded with Twitter and LinkedIn and Facebook from corporations, from banks, and from retailers, and you know, but for a nonprofit, in the nonprofit sector, it's very different. They don't have the funds necessarily to invest in marketing, and the type of content that you would post is very different. There isn't the volume of content, you know, because you're not selling in the same way. Mm-hmm. So there's not a constant, there's not a pipeline of constant content promoting the product. So I would say that is my experience of just, you know, the transition for a small company that deals with nonprofits, to actually, again, a small company, because I'm still with a small company, but they're much more engaged, and it's a tech oriented company. And so we're very aware of the potential for social media and digital engagement.
Right. And like you said, with the sector, I guess it also depends largely on the audience that they are catering to or trying to reach. And you did mention, you didn't mention Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn, which probably is more inclined, correct me if I'm wrong, please, but more towards baby boomers, Gen X, and millennials, I suppose. The rest of it, the rest of the platforms that are widely used is mostly for the Gen Z. Isn't that so?
Yes, from my understanding. I mean, at Facebook, obviously, is a bit older. I mean, for our demographic, we are focused on those three platforms. LinkedIn in particular, there's no Instagram whatsoever because of the nature of our business.
Right.
We're really looking at decision makers. We're looking at people who are established in the organization, because our goal really is to establish ourselves as thought leaders in our industry.
Right.
So we're really not targeting entry-level communication professionals.
Priyanka, coming to you now, how different is the approach to public relations and media in Canada as compared to India, given your experience, like we were just discussing a few minutes ago, that you've worked for over 12 years with a huge media network in India? So what are the differences that you've observed, and how does it work?
First of all, Palvi, thanks for having Simi and myself over for this conversation. I kind of want to take the same path as Simi and probably let you know that public relations was, it's media in itself is a really huge and wide umbrella, and public relations happens to be like one section, siloed section that we deal with, which is more about getting your organization's reputation in order and kind of trying and talking to it. But I was more engaged and involved with media, like broadcast media and news per se, for the first 12 years of my career when I was working for a major national news network in India. And it's funny how even when you mentioned that you were working for a network, people thought you were a journalist. Now that's really and that kind of shows the difference when you're actually talking about media as an industry and the approach to it as compared to Canada and India, where journalism is regarded as, if you're a reporter or an anchor, it's considered as this glamour industry where you're in front of the camera and you're kind of unearthing the truth. But there's a lot that goes behind it. There's a lot that that we as professionals who are in the business of getting that news to people and across to them, it's more than just being an anchor or a journalist or a reporter. So maybe circling back to the question of what's the difference between the media industry in Canada and here in India, is I think across the world, like world over, there's no question that faith in journalism is fragile and wavering. Maybe leaning more or skewed more in some countries or democracies as compared to the other. But overall, I feel that this notion of individuals feeling that news organizations are more concerned with supporting an ideology or political position is correct. And I did see that when, you know, and I do see that with Indian television news. And even though I've been here in Canada for the past 3 years and kind of pivoted completely from mainstream news broadcast to getting into financial sector and handling corporate communications for them, I still keep a tab to what's happening back home. And organizations across India, except a few, and I do have to mention that because I believe there are still few organizations and reporters who continue to carry forward the legacy of what journalism and media as a fourth pillar means or should mean to you know, to a democracy. So probably the fact that news or media and reporters are considered as not being objective or being partisan is somewhat true, because there's, you know, at some point where ad money supports media business model, and we did see like a fake TRP scandal in India recently. Like when things like these drive the nation, the people are bound to think about media as not making sense but sensationalizing stuff. So we've moved from, or the media industry perception has moved from being like the conscious keepers to, or the unravelers of wrongdoings to leaning towards factions. But that being said, it's funny because I came across a Edelman report recently, in the last weeks, where it mentioned that even Canadians don't trust media as an institution. And it's kind of declined over, especially over the past 1 year, where, and I actually did make a note of the number because it was amazing to me, because in my head I thought, oh, maybe the perception of Canadian media in Canadians who've kind of lived through it is different from what I would have who's been introduced to it in the last 3 years. But truth be told, it's amazing to kind of know or see that about 49% of Canadians surveyed feel that journalists and reporters are trying to mislead people. So this whole thing about us trying to compare media industries from one country to the other, I felt that was it did require some shaking up and being like, what can we learn from them, and what should we kind of, you know, tweak in our model so that the media industry is not considered as bipartisan or someone that's only kind of leaning towards factions and ideologies. But across the world, I feel this is what you know, people demand, especially with, like Simi said, with the influx of social media and anything and everything becoming news, or being kind of shared on Twitter and kind of, you know, making rounds or going viral. Each one of us wants to know the truth, and the media, which is supposed to be the gatekeeper for it, it's somehow the trust that's dwindling, and that's why people are kind of taking things more in their own hands. And I remember discussing this with you just a while ago, where one important difference that kind of pops in my head is how in India, the media industry or news per se, I must say, is it's not just quick and easy access, but it's more so to do with how quickly it spreads like wildfire, and even if it's fake news. So when people just start forwarding the content on WhatsApp, and you keep getting those notifications on family groups or people who keep sending you stuff on one faction over the other about, it could be anything. It could be about vaccines not being effective, or why did the government kind of go ahead with the vaccine when it was still in the testing phases, and the pros and cons. We actually forget to go deep and see where that, you know, what the source is that even trustworthy, and make an informed decision versus just spreading it forward like wildfire, and not stopping and checking ourselves by putting that barrier of questioning ourselves, saying, fine, this is from XYZ media, you know, like network, or this is from this commendable or a journalist who's kind of known for doing their work. But it's more to do with just spreading news for the sake of spreading it. So I, long story short, I feel that media as an industry and how news goes around in circles in both countries, it's somewhat similar, worse in some factions and democracies than the other. But yes, the fact that people still feel that, you know, the trust in media is deteriorating, I feel that's more of a concern that needs addressing than trying to understand where we stand when we put both of them on, you know, pitted against one another. So I feel if we've got a solution to it, we should be working towards that and trying to understand what we can learn from one and apply to the other.
Right. And going off of what you mentioned about news spreading like wildfire, I completely agree with you. And sometimes I do feel that it's like we're living in times where people are just by default expecting things to go wrong. And it's somehow like spreading that information, even if it might be fake, and not being able to validate it. It's like they don't want to stop to validate it because they're already expecting it. And they want to share it because then they can create more noise about it. And somehow this whole process itself allows them to vent in a way, vent out of, it could be their own personal things that they may not be able to share openly with people, but you know, kind of using news as a medium and as a way to vent their other emotions and just share that information. And and that's why. And when you say WhatsApp and family groups, it's so true. It's so right, because there's so much of, I get forwards sitting here in Canada. I get forwards from so many groups from back home, where they're sharing information that may not entirely be accurate, but I just read it and I stay away from reacting to it because I do my research and then I kind of realize how much of it I need to actually follow. But yeah, that makes so much sense. Simi, did you have anything to add to this?
Actually, I do. Thank you. It's ironic that the work I'm doing now with this company that conducts telephone town halls is best used. So we work with a number of with municipal and provincial governments, as I mentioned. And the main reason that they engage us is to address misinformation, rumors, and fear in the population, in their stakeholder groups, which is ironic that we're talking about this. We've been particularly busy in the last year. I started working with them because their business mushroomed from a one-person company to now it's just multiplied and it's growing by leaps and bounds. During COVID, where there were different stakeholder groups who were affected and didn't have information. And they really needed to know what was happening. You know, groups like, there was a particular group of people working in grocery stores. There were union members who were engaging with this provincial ministry and the situations that they were in with the public. You know, what do we do when someone won't keep their distance? I mean, as an employee, will I get fired for speaking firmly to this person? What are my rights? You know, there were a lot of issues. People were a year ago, terrified, you know, particularly essential workers they could not work remotely. That was not an option. They did not have paid sick leave. There was no talk about a vaccine at that point. I mean, it was people were panicked and they needed to engage with a trustworthy source. And so that is our main purpose, I would say, in that with government, certainly, is making sure that that information is coming from leadership and also giving leadership a finger on the pulse of their stakeholders. Where are the gaps in knowledge? And filling those vacuums so that people don't go to other sources which create a whole range of problems. So this is a serious issue. And this Edelman report that Priyanka mentions that came out a while ago really is a valuable resource. And I would commend people to take a look at it because it actually, and there's analysis, like there's a great article that I found that focuses on how this lack of trust has affected nonprofits and other sectors. Mm-hmm. And it does cut across different cultures. And I think you know, it's concerning. It's concerning that people aren't, as a culture, I think we have gotten away from analytical thinking and reflecting on the information. You know, when you read a newspaper, it was a very different interaction with the information than having it go into your brain immediately when you're sitting alone at a computer.
Absolutely.
You know, just having that pause to think, well, wait a minute. Yesterday, I read such and such a person. Hey, so-and-so, wife, husband, what do you think about this thing I just read in the news? And then there's conversation. And so I think it speaks to a much broader problem. And we've got to grapple with that as a society.
See, that's you know, that's the answer that we're looking for, that how do we create a solution by trying to engage people and see how we can rebuild the trust that you've lost in the system. So and so again, that's commendable when when you're trying to, when you're kind of shaken up by statistics, and these might not be mere statistics. It's more like, you know, like a barometer for you to kind of know if, you know, to gauge where you are. But when you're working towards making amends to what you think you've lost, that's the way forward. And I feel that's kind of lacking when I see the media industry or news, the way news, I don't think I should say media industry, because again, that's way too huge to define, but how news is kind of on its way or being turned or churned around for Indian viewers.
Right. I was thinking about our how we met. We met through college here in Canada, and in fact, Simi and I go way back, if I may say so, because we met at an interview at Humber, and then we re-met while we were studying. So collectively here right now in this room, we have close to four decades of work experience. However, coming back to college, I'm sure had its challenges. It did definitely for me. So what are some of your takeaways from this experience?
Okay, well, I'll start. I'm really very grateful for the opportunity to have gone back to school when I did to study PR and corporate communications. It was really valuable for me to take a pause, having worked in communications at the level I did, which wasn't really 100%. I wasn't really doing as much as I wanted to be doing, but I did have a taste of it. And so going to school at that point, I had really specific goals. I knew what where my gaps were and what I needed to know, and what, you know, I just needed clarification on some specific things. It was very helpful to have a little bit of work experience to bring to school. And it reset me, you know, it was like bringing me back to, you know, the reset button in your life, interacting with people from such different backgrounds, different ages. I mean, it was so valuable to have younger classmates who were, many of them, straight out of university. Their take and experience with the digital landscape was completely different from mine. So there was a cultural growth curve for me, as well as the industry learning curve. And that was, I mean, I'm just so grateful and thankful. It's kept me fresh and open-minded. And, you know, it forced me to confront my own biases and limitations. And, you know, it was a huge luxury to be able to do that. Many people don't have that option at a, you know, the midpoint in their lives to take a year out and focus on professional development that way. But it was, I can't say enough for how valuable it was. It taught me patience and where I needed to grow as a team member. Mm-hmm. The teamwork for me was the most challenging and valuable aspect of it, because I was used to working on my own, you know, getting instructions from my, you know, the CEO, mm-hmm. Or the VP of marketing, and going back to my office and doing my job. I had never worked on a team. And that was so critical. I mean, communications is all about teamwork on some level. I mean, obviously we're working remotely now, so it's not as close, you know, we're not in close quarters, which creates a lot of tension in itself and challenges, But it is so, so critical. And without that experience, I would not be I don't think my skill level would be anywhere near where it is now. So it was a very valuable experience. Challenging for sure, but very valuable.
Right. Priyanka?
So Simi and I were classmates, and I'm actually so glad that we met. And then we met you because you and Simi had, you know, interacted in the past.
Yeah.
But my journey to going back to college was not something that was on my mind initially. When I came to Canada, I came here as with a PR, like as an immigrant. And to me, having 12 years of experience in national news network, to me, it felt enough to gain ground and to find myself, back in the workforce. The only problem being that when you start comparing, again, Canada and India and the kind of news avenues and outlets, you've got really few national news networks here as compared to what you have in India.
Mm-hmm.
And trying to find people to connect with, to understand the differences in the industry and how you would go about it was a challenge for me in the first year. And so when I got thinking, it kind of gave me another view of how this could be a pivot and a chance for a second career. So it wasn't exactly a pivot because I was still kind of in the communications umbrella, the broad umbrella, but it was more to understand the nuances of the Canadian industry and the landscape and how things work here. And that drove me to a college, an intensive 8-month course for a postgraduate certificate in public relations and corporate communication, because I felt I wanted to capitalize on my strengths of trying to find harmony and being a relator and being an inclusive leader where I come from, and kind of putting those skill sets to use a section of communication that would most probably be like internal comms, trying to deal with employee engagement and trying to understand the best ways forward. So that's where I was looking at it. And to be honest, it was, I was really skeptical of going back to college because I was, I didn't know what to expect. Would there be like people my age? And like Simi voiced, I thought graduates fresh out of university, comparing my skill sets or my maturity level or work with them and what each of us would bring to the table and how we kind of sit together and brainstorm about the projects and how do we tackle this problem. It was skeptical on my end going into it, but once I was into it, there was no looking back because it was actually a really great experience where the approach, the practical approach was intended to prepare the cohort for the job market. And that's what I needed. The entire focus was in developing particular skill sets that would make us job ready. And sometimes it felt way too intensive where you didn't realize when the semester kind of got over and you're handling 7 subjects or 7 different, deliverables with your teammates within those 5 work days, but you're still kind of chugging along and making those projects or timelines with your teams. So it was a great learning experience because it taught you how to manage all these varied deliverables, how to work in a team, like Simi said. And for me, probably it was a lot more easier because I had always worked in a team culture and always led teams. So from that perspective, I always saw myself as the includer or someone trying to get harmony onto team conflicts and trying to understand how we can work best, especially when people have very different ways of working in teams. Some people might scramble and work towards deliverables and keep them on till the last minute. And some would make sure that, you know, if my work depended or if your work depended on my deliverable, they would make sure that they kind of keep their end of the bargain so that the team can move forward. But again, going back to the point of, it was a great cultural mosaic and I think Simi and I would agree on it when we say that it was great to sit together. And on some days when you could actually have time to share lunch with your teammates and your friends, exchange recipes or maybe talk about, oh, what do you have? Or you know, how does it happen with you back home? Or just trying to be more observant and start working on your own biases or start learning more about, you know, not just your teammates, but cultures world over. But one thing I do probably want to mention, this was my college experience, but I often used to think, about how universities work back in India and how things kind of take shape here in Canada. And that was, that is something that kind of amazed me. And I felt, I wish I had this particular opportunity. I wish the Indian university education system was somewhat similar. And by that, I mean that in universities here in Canada, you know, when you're doing your undergrad or like your master's, you have a holistic view and the opportunity to pick up subject or streams that you might be interested in or you have a knack for. And you might, and not necessarily coming from, if you're a communication or, if you're a student of architecture, or if you're a student of electronics, you cannot venture out or explore anything else away from your domain. You here in Canada, in universities, you are encouraged, or you have the opportunity to major in electronics or architecture, but also minor in media and film studies. So that kind of gives you a sense of, oh, maybe I'm good at it, or no, maybe I just thought I was good at it. You know, maybe I'm good at PR and communications, but no, this is not my forte. Maybe human resources or marketing or sales is my forte. But till the time I am not given the opportunity to try and fail or try and learn for myself if I'm good at it or not, I will never know. And that's something that I'm probably struggling with right now, because I would, as soon as, you know, you get your 10th grade results or in India, you're kind of put into buckets of you're a commerce student, you're a science student, you're an art student. And that kind of drives your life forever. And then what if I want to 15 years down the line be like, I want to learn how to code. Can I do that? Yes, I can. I have the opportunities, but it's so much more difficult doing it 15 years into your work life than trying it at university level and failing or realizing, oh no, I have a knack for it. Maybe I'm more interested in this. So I feel that was something that I wanted to bring up or share, you know, when I saw the university education system and the differences here. And again, to the point, colleges in Canada, it's different from universities. Colleges are more fast track. So that's how they're supposed to be. A Canadian college degree will help you, you know, get those practical skill sets to be ready for the job market. But universities would kind of be the 2-year masters or the degree courses that kind of help you develop a holistic view. So that I think that was the only thing I wanted to kind of bring forward, apart from my experience going back to college after so many work years.
So my next question is kind of connected to that. I read in an article from The Insider recently, which was titled that the Gen Zers are less progressive than millennials, about gender identity and stereotypes. Not getting into the political aspects of this, but given that we are in an age of technology and quote unquote a tap away from information, what is your understanding of this statement as communication professionals?
I can only speak to that in a very narrow way. I can't say I'm super knowledgeable about that because I haven't really experienced it very much. I can only relate to you an anecdote from experience I had at my my previous position before I went back to school, where there was a presentation made to the staff on gender pronouns and how to use them, when to use them, why to use them. So this would have been about 5 years ago when it was a fairly new idea on a broad scale outside the LGBTQ community. And the president of the company, after the presentation, just expressed complete skepticism. She was not a senior citizen. She was, I guess, at that point in her 50s, but she had been running the company for over 20 years and really did not have an HR background. And she didn't see the purpose of specifying her own pronouns and asking people what their pronouns are, which was the instruction given in the workshop that whenever engaging with a new employee, that would be the protocol to follow. And she actually felt that that would be inappropriate. Otherwise, I've really not heard people vocalize their resistance to it. I think it's a delicate issue. I think there would be discomfort on a in a business meeting for people to individuals to express discomfort with the idea of gender roles and so on. It's a very, I think that would be, might be expressed privately. Mm-hmm. So I'm sorry, I can't offer more. I haven't seen a lot of open, and plus we're in Toronto, don't forget. This is ground zero for same-sex marriage, which was formally legalized 15 years ago. I mean, long before it happened in any state in the United States.
Right.
So we're particularly, I think, sensitive and progressive politically on this issue in Toronto, not across Canada maybe, but certainly Toronto.
Right.
I agree with Simi's point with Toronto as a city being ground zero for and helping to bring about changes, because as funny as it sounds, even today we've got I actually recently came across a cry for help. A colleague who works with queer and transgender and non-binary folks. She, you know, it kind of showed how families in India would still force their kids to follow rules, to be closeted or be cut off from anything and everything, be it money for their education, be it a place to stay, be it, you know, like forcing them to be someone who they're not. So even though we say we've progressed, it just might be on paper. But coming back to your questions on or my take on why we think, or why I think that Gen Y might be more progressive, millennials might be more progressive when talking about gender identity, is because I feel that they were the ones who had to push back. They were the ones who kind of lived that experience or had to work hard to make their voices heard. And that's why they kind of took upon themselves to make the change, to make their voices heard, and that's why they feel more strongly about it. For Gen Z, which is people in the 18 to 24, they already had the movement. They kind of dipped their toes in it because the movement was already in progress. The movement had gained momentum by them, and there were so many things that had changed by the time they actually realized what gender identity means and, you know, what these distinctions are. But from a communications point of view, I think not, and again, because this is a very it's a politically sensitive conversation to have. For organizations, not just to you know, put themselves on the map or say that we're an inclusive, you know, culture, or we believe in having gender equality across board and in leadership roles and otherwise. I feel to reach or connect with your audience meaningfully, you have to stop pretending and actually believing and, you know, talking about these things or showing that you really care. It could be in the kind of gender-based advertising that you do, or like personal self-care products about personal self-care, or things like basically walking the talk and not just saying we believe in this, but showing how you believe in gender parity or you know, gender identity, and having conversations that might be uncomfortable for so many, but if this is what's required, it needs to be done. So I totally agree with maybe that Gen, you know, the millennials, Gen Y is more progressive, but there's a reason to it, because they were the ones who really pushed the boundaries for it and came out and started asking the right questions and, you know, trying to understand the why and why nots. So it could be, and probably Gen Z might have kind of caught on to the momentum and may not think of it as progressively as millennials.
Coming to the end of our show, and we just have one final question. As communications professionals, if there was one practice in communications that you could hold on to from the past years, what would it be and why?
To me, I feel it's definitely trust and integrity. As communication practitioners, as media, as an industry, like I feel we've kind of lost that because we're so driven by vanity metrics and numbers, and making statements without believing in them and not walking the talk with them. So that should be like that to me, that to me speaks a lot about what we were and where we've come and what should we, you know, take along with us if we want to make sure that we're on the right path. And something that and another probably practice that I would say from my personal experience is meaningful mentoring and sponsoring of talent. Like I feel this was something that I faced when I came here, when I had no one to reach out to, where to, especially people who've been in the news network. It wasn't easier for an immigrant like myself to reach out and request them for an information interview when it came to just trying to understand how the news networks work here, just trying to understand the industry. So I think for me, those were the two big, for the industry, it was definitely trust and integrity that we need to carry forward. And for me, maybe more opportunities for meaningful mentorship.
I couldn't agree more with what Priyanka said. I think to take a different approach to your question, Pallavi, I think that the industry is evolving and the landscape is evolving so quickly. I look at it a bit differently, not so much looking back on what's worked, but learning from the opportunities that have presented itself in the industry, and lack of diversity is one that sort of is raised for me when there have been gaffes where the messages have been really off the mark, and there's been a huge blowback. I'm thinking in terms of communications in a broad sense, like marketing and advertising, which I include in the under the communications umbrella. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can give a specific example. The most recent thing that comes to mind, I know there are others, where there was, I guess this would have been maybe 4 years ago, where one of the Jenner girls was featured in a Pepsi commercial where there were police officers with guns drawn or rifles drawn, and she was shown putting a flower down the barrel of one of these rifles. I don't know if either of you were, you would not have been in Toronto perhaps, or aware of that in the time. I don't know if you don't, but those types of things do happen. And to me, that goes to a lack of diversity at the decision-making level and on the staff level, at the creative level. And so just going back to what Priyanka said, I think nurturing talent like us, who are coming from different backgrounds, I struggled too. And that was the main reason why I went back to school, was that I couldn't break through. I couldn't break into the industry, even though I had a lot of experience that was applicable, that made me, I think, a strong candidate. I had strong skills that would have lent itself well to it without going back to school, but no one would give me a chance at the time. I tried for years. And so I think the industry, we need to find a way to embrace people who are coming in from other, making lateral changes, as well as going across cultural divides, to bring people in who have other experiences and other skill sets. That will only strengthen our industry, and I think make our products speak to a bigger audience, because we'll be sensitive to those things and bring other messages to the fore that other people might not have thought of or be aware of, you know, like, you know, having women and not just men. You know, obviously communications is largely populated by women, but that's just an example. If it were just male oriented, which, you know, 20 or 30 years ago, it might've been, you know, it seems absurd now to think, well, how could you exclude women? Like, that's a huge number of consumers who are out there, who are women, who need that viewpoint, is excluded. It's just the same thing goes to other groups of people and other experiences. So I think nurturing that talent and finding ways, I'm certainly open to doing that. It's not going to be easy, because of the way that the industry is structured. It's sort of a closed club right now. But I think moving forward, it's essential that we do that.
Absolutely.
Simi, you couldn't have said it better, Simi. Thank you for putting it in those many words, because I don't know if you remember, you know, when we were trying to find internships during our like the end of semester, this conversation about would you want to go for a PR agency versus would you want to go for an organization, like more like the internal comms or corporate communication way of things. And I remember, even though I never wanted to get into the agency side, another big factor for my aversion was when I opened the, you know, when I tried to understand the teams that work at these agencies, I just couldn't relate to the faces or the team structure that was in there. Like, I could only see faces that I am not familiar with. There was no diversity, there was no cultural inclusion, and that made me cringe, and that made me feel if I want to fight that battle, like it really kind of put me off. And anyways, I wasn't interested in doing the agency route, because I knew that I wanted to probably play on my strengths and continue on the corporate or internal comms side of things. But you're really right, Simi. The lack of diversity in the industry per se is something that probably we're fighting with. And it just kind of speaks to the content that is thrown at us again without having those checks of will it relate with each member or, you know, every viewer or audience, or are there certain barriers that we should be mindful of because it's being shared with the kind of audience across. So thanks for sharing that.
Well, thank you both for being here today on the show and making the time on a Sunday morning. It's been wonderful, and I definitely hope you enjoyed it as much as I did, and I would love to have you back on the show soon.
Thank you so much for inviting us, Pallavi.
Thanks, Pallavi. Thanks, Simi. Nice connecting with you guys again.
Next week, we're coming back with our episode from the Tiny Tuck Show. So stay tuned for some interesting stories of success. Till then, stay safe and spread the love.